be making sure you stay amused. They'll fill you up with drugs and booze. Maybe you'll make the evening news. And when you're tripping over your dreams, they'll keep you down by any means. By the end of the night.
Afternoon and welcome to Barely Broadcasting, the show all about us, the film and broadcasting students of DIT School of Media. I'm your host Suzanne Stapleton, and today we'll be walking you through the highs and the lows of the course. DIT's Film and Broadcasting is a four-year course that's all about telling stories. Half of our modules are practical, the other half theory. We shoot shorts, we edit, and we get depressed about our lack of job prospects. Today, I'll be talking to the lovely third-year-turned-second-year student, Katie Doyle, the always loud Shane Morgan, and the chameleon actor, Zach Van Standen, about their first experiences of the course, their equipment woes, their time in second year, and their hopes and dreams for the future. All right, lads, how are we doing today?
Good.
Thanks for coming. Thanks for being here. Before we get into the thick of it, first up, here's a little taster of what's to come from some of the other fine students of DIT Film and Broadcasting.
What got you interested in filmmaking?
Well, it's kind of the only thing I've ever really been interested in. Like, nothing else really excited me the way the idea of making a movie did. And yeah, I mean, I saw Blue Velvet in like 2011, I want to say. And I just thought, like, if someone could put together a narrative that's that cohesive and like affecting and sort of well put together, like that's like the goal. Like I just wouldn't want anything else in life.
I've always really liked movies ever since I was little, like really big into like movies like Gone with the Wind and Casablanca. So it was always something I thought, when I'm old enough, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to study.
I liked writing stories, I liked movies, I liked dramas, soap operas, so I started thinking maybe this could be something that I could do myself.
So guys, I guess I'll, you know, what brought you here? What got you into DIT Film Broadcasting? Why are you here? Why are we here?
Why am I here? I put on my CAO.
I suppose that's true.
Same.
Obviously same. I think I decided to do film when... I think it's a combination of... I've always liked storytelling. I read from a really young age, but then I think I also was a very visual person. I used to like steal Vogue and Dazed and ID from Easton's every week and stuff. So I have like stacks and stacks of magazines in my room. So it's a combination of the two things that I love, which is like, you know, narrative storytelling, but you've got that like visual element as well. So I wanted to work in film, yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, Katie.
Yeah. So like, what got you guys into movies? Like, what was that movie that you were like, yeah, this is what I want to do?
There wasn't like a certain movie that I like, was like, shit, that's the bomb.
Yeah.
I was more interested in like how all the movies were made, basically.
Yeah.
Like looking at behind the scenes footage of Lord of the Rings.
Which is
the
just
Hobbit,
incredible.
It was like crazy.
Yeah.
Just, like, shit, how did they do that? So that's how I was just like,
I could do that.
I could do that.
Yeah.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
Bit of banter.
Yeah. Just a bit.
My mom, like, in a very genuine, real way, used to like, in that junior state year, like, lock me in my bedroom and be like, study for your junior state.
Relatable.
She stayed before, I'd be insane. But like, so am I. And I love you, Mom. But I would just like, in my weird like protest, which is ultimately just self-sabotaging because I did a kind of bad junior state then, was I would just watch movies on my laptop. And I was like, obviously around in Tumblr's heyday. So like all of the sort of like classic Tumblr films, like Heather and Donnie Darko and stuff, like Girl Interrupted. Yeah.
Everything that made you like an edgy teenager.
Yeah, you want to put on like your Instagram, like next, like a selfie of you with an online
fan. Just a little quote, like, Donnie Darko.
And like, how much you relate to it or whatever. What's the big Donnie Darko quote?
Oh, God.
It's a great. Oh, never mind. Yeah. Anyway, that was the start of my journey. And then I got really passionately into like the French New Wave and
So you became a real film student.
Yeah, then I like grew up from the film. Even though like Heathers will always have such a... It's an amazing movie. It still stands. But yeah, I was just really passionate about different like slightly avant-garde film movements and stuff. And I really like the theory of it. It just suits me with this course. And the like history of it and stuff. So yeah, that was... But Heathers was my first baby.
The one. Yeah. What about you, Zach?
Yeah, I guess just growing up, like, watching films as a form of entertainment, the same way you'd, like, listen to music, it was just, like, a part of your life.
Yeah.
And, like, I think films, like, even more so than music, has, like, a powerful effect to make you feel different emotions.
Oh, yeah, like, I cry happy, sad, all the time watching movies.
So I just think that's, like, a really powerful characteristic of film. And
you related to it, you were just, like... The power.
Yeah, I was like, I want that power. I want to make people feel things.
Yeah.
So I guess like that's one aspect of why I got into it.
So we asked three lovely students how their first days went in DIT. Let's roll that tape.
What were your first impressions of the course on your first day and in general?
Well, everyone I was with was terrified, which was kind of comforting. I thought, like, okay, it can't be that bad because I'm probably the most comfortable person here. And I thought, well, I'm in a position to help other people then because it's really not that bad. It was really, really easy at the start. Like, they ease you in, like, really well.
I just remember the first day sitting down, not knowing anyone, not knowing what was going on, just being really shy and timid.
First day, I remember going in and, into that big room and... Yeah, first person I talked to was Gail.
The first person I talked to was Nicola, I think. Yeah, she was the first person I sat beside in orientation, and then we got bubble tea.
Yeah, I was quite frightened. Still kind of frightened, but yeah, it's good. I'm glad I'm doing it. It's really fun.
I remember the first day kind of blurrily just because I could only remember like certain bits and pieces. What about you guys? Like, how do you remember the first day? Like the people you spoke to,
like the actual first day or like the introduction?
The introduction day I was so embarrassed.
Sort of traumatized.
Because it was just after electric picnic.
Oh no.
And I was like covered in hickeys, which are the most juvenile things in the world. Like, who gives hickeys? It's not fun.
Yeah.
Like, who does that? But I got with someone, and obviously it was electric picnic. So
yeah,
like,
you're doing it,
planet monged. And like, my neck was destroyed. But I was just sitting in this room full of like, you know, my future peers.
Yeah.
And I had my YouTube earrings, like a full buzz cut, and my neck was literally brown. But I feel like that was sort of like prescient. Like, I advertised to you all, like, I'm an unreliable hedonistic slut, like, from day one, but, like, stayed pretty true to that.
I was
very hyper self-aware.
I feel like, there's a kind of, like, I cursed anyone I spoke to on the first day, because, like, they're all gone. They're all gone. Except for Michaela, shout out to you, girl, I'm praying for you. Everyone else is gone. So, maybe that was a problem that I caused, probably, personally. What about you guys?
Yeah, I remember we had like some task where we had to go around Dublin City and I can't even remember what it was. Were we taking photos of something?
You had to like take selfies with like landmarks.
With strangers as well.
But taking selfies in public is like the worst. It's just so embarrassing.
Like, I mean, like, as a vain girl, like, I can't really relate, but yeah.
Well, you know I'm a selfie.
Did you just win t-shirts or something?
I mean, I didn't. I don't think we were supposed to post them on Twitter, which was the whole tea, and our team didn't.
In my induction, it was like every single person got a film and broadcasting T-shirt at the end.
Oh my god, dickheads! Yeah. We got nothing. School of media.
Budget.
I'd like a wig.
Like, so after that first day, did you guys feel like you made the right kind of choice? Like, did you feel like coming out of that room, you were like, yeah, I did it.
No. Like, they asked me to take selfies on, like, the streets of Dublin. Yeah. I think it genuinely took till second semester for me to fully be like, I have made the right choice. Like, I loved it theoretically, but I also, like I loved, like, the modules and stuff that we're doing, but my first semester I wasn't having a college experience. Like, I moved up from Cork, and I did find it disorientating a bit. Like, not as much as I thought I would have, because I'm, like, a born city slicker. Like, it's where I'm meant to be. bigger the better in every sense. No, it was like, I think I wasn't like solidly like, yes, this is for me until second semester.
Yeah.
And then I got to second semester of second year and I was like, maybe this isn't for me. I've done a full like Mobius strip.
I feel like I did the opposite, personally. Like, I don't feel like I fully came into my stride until, like, first semester this year, and then I was thrown completely off my stride again, and now I'm, like, back in it. But first year for me was just kind of like, what's going on?
Yeah.
I don't know, I can't.
Can't remember. It's so long ago for Katie, she can't remember.
Oh, fuck. Can't.
Yeah, I've had two first days as well. Yeah. So
well, you had a first day with us as well. How was that? Bit trash, I'm assuming.
Oh god, yeah, I walked into audio and everybody, it was only this half of the class, everybody's just sitting around and we had to, everybody had to introduce themselves and they were like, who is this ginger girl? Like, I was like, I work in Saba.
You always bring up your job, like all the time. I was like, I work in Saba. It's like, oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gosh. Yeah, it was grand. Still grand.
Yeah, still grand, you're still alright. But like, so we closed out first year, it was over, we were good, we were done with it. What were like your, like I guess your highs and lows, any like stories you want to share about that first year experience?
I feel like we didn't get adept or like proper instruction in the practical side of things until this year. So that was my thing, was I always, I've been such a bookish freak nerd, like because I was just so annoying as a child that I didn't really make any friends till like 14, so I very much took to books. So I've always loved the theory parts of stuff, and then I was glad that that was available in this course.
Mm.
But I did the practical stuff, which I knew that I signed up for practical stuff, which I knew I would hate because I was like, I do want to work and like translate that theory into practice. And I feel like it was such a mess in first year, really, that I didn't get any grounding in that. So I was dissatisfied on that front, but super energized like intellectually. I felt like I'd learned more in that year than I had through like all of secondary education. I was like, I'm like developing at such a quick rate.
Yeah,
I'd say it was like harder for people that came in not knowing anything, because I'd done the course before before I came in here, so like I knew how to use Premiere Pro and knew how to use like all the stuff, so like it was, I didn't find it like that like traumatizing, I'd say, like the way you were just like, I didn't know really how to use stuff, like we weren't really directed.
Yeah, it was more there was just such a lack of instruction. I wasn't traumatized as much as like pissed off and confused,
exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
It's just like, so, you know, what's a camera?
Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, I kind of, because I didn't do a course before I came in either, like I just kind of came in and the whole practical side of things was super daunting to me, just like from the get-go, because a load of people had come in with like a background of knowledge.
Yeah.
And I had none, like we didn't do film in school, we didn't do media, there was no like tech stuff, all girls school, South Dublin. So it was, you know, like do home ec or perish. So like these are the facts. So coming in, it was very, very intimidating, and walking into a room full of people who seem like they know what they're doing definitely isn't exactly like conducive to making other people kind of want to take the step forward and like go for it.
Kind of learn, I think, though, that everyone is fronting.
Everybody,
and quite 100%.
Like, I was just
about
to say
that.
I still feel that very quickly, it becomes clear that
everyone's just making a mess in line
and just
by the skin of their teeth is getting through.
We're all just figuring it at the same time. And I feel like no matter how much grounding you have in one facet of the course, the technical side, there's always someone else who's better at something else.
Yeah.
And I feel like that, like it genuinely is such a mixed bag with the like makeup of our course, like in such a bizarre and like brilliant way. Everyone's on a completely different fucking page. So like when we get together, it's like, what is gonna come out of this at the end? But it generally, I feel like we're learning like together and from one another, which is, it sounds really corny, but
yeah.
I feel like that's the most productive part of the whole course is actually working.
Yeah.
Getting down to it.
Yeah, I still don't know what the Frankfurt School is. Please, somebody tell me.
Okay. Right. So, but it's not all sunshines and daisies and Frankfurt School here. Equipment is always a problem, from lagging Macs, missing recorders, to digital disasters. To give us a taste of how things used to be, Here's Rory O'Hushin with a tour of the obsolete equipment from days past.
Hey, welcome to the DIT room of obsolete equipment that is probably still somewhat usable. Here we have a lot of really, really powerful lenses, like your average 1.9, 7.3 to 102 millimeter lens. We don't have anything even really comparable to that nowadays. Sort of the problem with a lot of this equipment is, number one, some of it is obsolete, like we couldn't use it nowadays, but we could use it to learn what used to be done. Like there's an old film camera over there that I'm sure with a little bit of love could still be put to work. We have loads of lenses that, I mean, we could learn from, not only in the way that they work and just the way that older cinema equipment works, but also in just comparison with what we have nowadays, there really is nothing that is even remotely like it. The standard lens we shoot on is an f4 24 to 105, and we don't have any other lenses to work with that 5D except for a 50 millimeter. And these are far more versatile lenses at way lower f-stops. This is gorgeous, but we've never even thought about shooting on it because it's just up here with all of this other stuff gathering dust. I mean, they're Arri and Zeiss equipment that's just sitting here doing nothing. And I really think that a lot of this stuff should be relooked at, really just to see what we can do with it to learn, rather than just throwing it away because it's seen as obsolete. So another thing to consider is just the fact that we have ludicrous amounts of film and we don't even really consider shooting on film. It's a film course, but we shoot entirely digital. When it for a while seemed like digital was the way of the future, and nobody was going to keep on shooting on film because the turnaround time is so much slower. You still have films like Dunkirk, like Star Wars, all of these amazing films that are winning awards and they're having money poured into them shooting on film. Like The Phantom Thread was entirely shot on film, and it's one of the most beautiful films of the past year. We have all of this film. We have more down in the offices. We have all of this equipment that could be put to work, again, to learn from, not necessarily to use ultimately in making our films, because obviously we may not be able to do something in one day with a film camera. But to garner knowledge as to how we got to the digital era and what all of the things that we use nowadays mean and where they came from.
So guys, having seen that kind of DIT of yesteryear when she was new and state of the art, like, what are your thoughts on kind of where we stand now in terms of equipment? How are you feeling?
Yeah. I think like he's making a good point, Rory. Like we have all this stuff just up in the attic and we've never seen it before. Like, what is this? Like, I don't know. Like, maybe I should know. It holds film?
Yeah. Good. Yes, it does. Well done.
I thought it was a tin of biscuits.
But like, it's all just up there. Like, we definitely should be checking it out, seeing what it is, like how films used to be made.
Because
back in the
beautiful
day.
Like, yeah. Film is so much nicer than digital. Like, yeah. I would love to not learn to shoot on film because I hate, like, learning and cameras and stuff. But I'd love if someone else learned how to shoot on film and then, like, direct one of my scripts. Do DOP. Because I think it, like, it doesn't age, like, at all. When you see, like, a good film picture, I think it stands up better than most of the digital stuff that we see now. And obviously it's like inordinately expensive and restrictive in a lot
Very
of ways.
To.
But I think we should definitely have the option to, you know, try different things aesthetically and stuff. Groovy.
Yeah, even if it was just like a small section of a course, maybe just like one module for a semester, just like testing out film and like getting to actually make short films on film, that I think that would be like really just beneficial to like broaden our horizons in terms of like filmmaking.
Also, because I think there's a cultural like push back towards film now,
yeah,
especially in photography, because they say the point is often made that digital is kind of like disconcerting and a bit ugly to look at if it's sharper than your eye. You know what I mean? There's like that Jurassic Park anecdote where I think they degraded all of the footage because it just looked too good and they were like, it's actually kind of ugly. And you see like most photographers working now are working in 35 millimeter film.
Yeah.
I think it'd be like Santuos.
The thing is people just want to replicate the look because it is so beautiful. Yeah. And like, I know we just for fun took some of the stuff down from the attic there a couple weeks back and like threaded 16 mil film. And just like even we timed Rory himself with the bag doing it like you're not like, supposed to see it and stuff. And like just seeing that and knowing that people still shoot on film and like that's how it is on major sets and stuff and having to go into that like blind, literally and like figuratively not knowing how to do it, I feel like you just get laughed off, like you just get laughed out of it.
Yeah, that would definitely be handy. But on the equipment front, I'm not really an equipment girl, so like I don't have a huge amount of thoughts, but the computers are so fucking slow. Like I went to export a project from After Effects that is a minute and 18 seconds long the other day, and it took like an hour. It wouldn't export because it said there wasn't enough room on my fucking computer, so then I put it on a USB, and then it like after like 30 minutes exported it to my USB, but when I went to play it, just like stopped halfway through, and it was just a still for the second half. And I actually cried. It stressed me out so much. And they're all so fucking slow. And like, I don't know if like, maybe I'm just shit and that is what you deal with in the industry.
I was trying to export my film there like last semester or early this year, I think it was. And like, it took like over an hour to export it. And you just have to render like every so often just to like have it like play smoothly while you're editing. And it's just such a pain in the ass.
Oh yeah, the lag just, it makes everyone look horrible. Everything looks ugly. You can't edit in like proper time because it's just like. For anyone watching, that was not an actual DIT lag. That was just me, an actress.
That's so convincing.
I know.
Will you be in my next film? Yeah.
A few more computers actually will be good.
Oh yeah. If there was enough space for everyone, because I feel like there's almost an expectation that people are just going to drop off, like drop out like flies.
Because they give you so many new computers.
So few computers.
Can you imagine if our like whole course, like nobody dropped out, like the situation this year with animation.
Like if we still had like 35/40 people, like what would we do?
Yeah, they wouldn't even fit in the room.
No, there's been three animation classes where, literally fucking three, because my thing is always to kind of arrive 15 minutes late, but like no later, but like almost always exactly 15 minutes. So I've always missed a chair in animation and I just have to sit beside someone and like watch them edit for 2 hours.
Yeah.
Which is soul destroying.
It is a bit bleak.
You're not learning like
No, not at all.
You should come to class early.
honestly, the rest of us come to class. The rest of us get to Brian's class 15 minutes early to get a chair.
Okay, yeah, no.
Like, it's literally like musical fucking chairs at this point. Everyone's just trying to get in. I know, Zach, I think you've gotten a seat every week.
I think one week I
one
didn't
week
get
you
one.
Didn't get it.
Thank God for, like, Rory and his, like, MacBook and people who, like, brought in stuff.
Oh, yeah, actually bring in their own
people who have their own stuff,
Rich fucks.
but that's all part of the parcel.
The revolution.
Of second year. It's a changed game. Everyone's stepping it up. How have you guys found it? Have you been finding it good, difficult? Like, what about shooting the films? I know, Zach, you shot your film and you edited. you were there too, Shane.
I was cute. No, I did bits.
How was that for you then?
Yeah, like, the shoot, like, went very smoothly. It was very good. You were in it. You were
I forgot I was in it.
It must have been that good.
You killed it.
But yeah, that was, like, a really fun experience. On set, it was the second film I directed here.
Barely Broadcasting.
The second film I directed here, and it went a lot better than the first one, so always progressing. I think people thought I was a bit of a diva in the first year, maybe. But this year went a lot smoother.
I mean, everyone grows, everyone changes.
Definitely.
First year me is not second year me by any stretch.
It's insane. I think when I look at it versus secondary school, where I feel like that was like 6 years of like stasis, and I was just like the same ugly emo. And then it's like the rapidity of change and development here, because you kind of come in and they're just like, especially in second year, Tom is just like, you know, you walk into the studio and he's like, right, do it. Set shit up, and I'm not gonna hold your hand, you know. And I think you just have to come to grips with it because you have no other choice. You have deadlines and lots of things to make. So like you definitely progressed more in in first year with video modules. It's very much like,
la-di-da.
This is a camera, like this is a lens. All right, let's watch a movie. You know what I mean? Where it's like,
here's a
like
documentary from 1984 talking about film.
So I think, yeah, definitely. I feel like as well as like a person, like you develop hugely. Because like film is, it is an inherently collaborative art form, and I've learned what I need to learn is to like be less
Let
of a dick,
go.
You
yeah.
know, because you're constantly working on a team, and it doesn't matter how like passionate or like singular your vision for something is, like you can't execute it without the help of the people around you. So you need to be accommodating.
It takes a village, like you really do have to.
Yeah.
Like, I was shooting a film over the weekend, and due to unforeseen circumstances, we ended up with a crew of about 4 people. And I've discovered that the smallest number of crew you should definitely have to shoot a film is probably 5.
Yeah.
Just one more.
Someone to get the coffee.
Yeah, just someone to be like, oh, you know, you've left the equipment over there and it's going to get robbed. Like, you know, just one more person. But it really does, like, make me feel so, like, pleased by the fact that we have, like, all of these people who are so creative, who want to do this, who are all just really invested in, like, being a part of a team and part of the industry and, like, working hard to make something great.
Yeah.
Because, like, everyone cares. Everybody gives at least partial damn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We've definitely started to give a shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think our group, there's like a delay. Like, we went a few weeks trying to find a shit to give. But, like, we found a few now and we hit a stride a week before we're done. But no, I do think, it's back to that. It's like we're so surrounded by, like, really creative and really intelligent and driven, hardworking people here. I think for me, it's just learning, like, maybe for all of us, it's just how you get this like multiplicity of like visions and worldviews and then like point it down into a singular thing and like work together in the world. I think that's the like main trick that you want to have mastered by the time you leave film school, really.
Yeah.
It's how to be like one unit while still being like a group of individuals who have different talents.
I'll preach it.
Yeah, I mean,
give
us a little lecture there, a little seminar. So speaking of leaving film school, I know no one wants to. But we're 2 years in, halfway through the future. We gotta start talking about it.
I
know. Me too.
I don't know what I'm doing next week, so I'll ask
you this. That's very fair. But what are your hopes going forward? What are you thinking about? What are you looking forward to in third year? We all make it.
Hopefully we all make it.
Yeah.
I think the documentary module is gonna be pretty interesting. I know Richard's doing that. Shout out to my boy.
Yeah, I love it.
So that should be interesting. I'm not sure, is that like a semester each we get to do?
Like a documentary and then advanced documentary?
Mm. Yeah, I think if you specialize documentary, then you get the second semester.
Okay. Do you specialize halfway through your third year?
Yeah, I think the second semester you pick,
Well, balls and dick, like we're away on Erasmus.
Yeah, but that's fine. They pick, like, I think you pick in semester two.
Okay, groovy.
We're going on Erasmus in case you didn't catch that.
Yeah.
That's our plan. Shout out. What about you, Katie?
What am I excited for?
Yeah. What are you looking forward to?
I'm sort of excited for documentary, I guess.
You seem really enthused by it.
There's like an exam that you have to put up a tripod and a camera and a tripod.
Is that an exam?
Yeah. For
Does everyone pass if they pass? Is it pass-fail?
No, I think it's like just part of it. Like.
Trash.
I would literally fail.
I think the fact that we will be starting into documentary, because like obviously we've not done any until now, so it'll be really good to get like a grounding in that.
Because I'm leaning towards that as my like specialization,
cool.
like between drama, radio, and doc, because I think with drama I have like a kind of off-kilter taste that is not, it's just like niche and kind of boring to most people. And I feel like that's not the kind of stuff that generally I see get greenlit by DIT. So I feel like documentary, I think I'd have actually slightly more wiggle room to do something like slightly left of field. And also then like the French New Wave movements that I've mentioned, they've often been like, most of my filmmakers bring a real documentary sensibility to what they make.
Well,
and it's
like political filmmaking, really.
But it's also like just shit like do it on no budget, use natural lights and stuff like that. And I really like sort of realism in cinema and sort of like non-actors. And so I feel like, yeah, I'm going to go down. Even I'm looking at Radio 2 because I feel like a bit of an epiphany last week. And I was like, I fucking love the sound of my own voice so much. So maybe I should be like a podcaster. Like some sort of cultural critic. Because I love just being mean about things.
Podcasts are on the up and up. So
yeah, it's like it's a real thing now.
Yeah.
Don't know how I'd monetize it because I like don't believe in
ads. I mean, Casper, Audible, shout out.
I'm just gonna marry really rich though. Is my primary That's your plan. Primary plan. Okay. Everything else is sort of malleable, but like get that rich dick. It's like has been a solid aspiration for a few years.
What about you, Zach? Primary plan, future.
For what, third year or for just?
I guess and beyond.
I don't know. Just keep doing, keep making films, keep progressing, getting better at it. That's all I have so far.
They're good goals. They're good, solid goals.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd be the same. See what comes. Goes.
That's so sad.
All right, then. Well, that's all we've got time for. This has been Barely Broadcasting, Barely Broadcasted. Thanks for tuning in.
To come from your private